Hello, I am Dr. Larissa Aviles-Santa, Director of the Division of Clinical and Health Services Research at the National Institute on Minority Health and Health Disparities at the National Institutes of Health. And welcome to this new lecture on health research linked to disasters and other humanitarian crises. Some of you, like me, were born or lived in places or in countries, regions that are prone to natural disasters. Or you may have witnessed or lived through natural disasters or have even volunteered to work in the response and recovery after natural or man-made disasters. Or like many of us on most of the globe, we have witnessed very close the effects of local and global epidemics. So why do we perform, or why is health research needed in the context of disasters and other humanitarian crises? We are aware that disasters happen everywhere and more often than we recognize them. The magnitude of disasters varies, and so their immediate effects. Some natural events tend to happen within predictable and cyclical weather patterns like hurricanes, typhoons, snowstorms, and others are unpredictable. And although some types of disasters can be predicted, their impact is often not known until they happen. But with adequate preparedness, damages could be reduced and recovery accelerated. In the midst of the chaos and tragedy, some individuals or populations seem to be resilient or even have implemented effective mitigation after previous events. We witnessed and are aware of immediate impact of disasters in human lives. And as clinical researchers, clinicians, or experts in public health, this should be both of concern and interest, since some members of our communities would experience greater impact due to their socioeconomic status, the location of their homes, their material and emotional losses, and or their health status and medical needs prior to these events. And depending on the state of the infrastructure and resources of those communities and the health status of the human beings that live in them, recovery from disasters could last a few years or several decades. And the recovery can further be extended if other disasters hit. In this lecture, I will briefly provide an overview of the types of humanitarian crises and disasters and the disaster recovery continuum. I will also discuss the purpose of health research linked to humanitarian crises and go over some of the proposed frameworks for this disaster recovery that are also applicable to health research related to disasters. I will also highlight from the literature some challenges in performing health research linked to disasters and opportunities to do further research in this field. Now, let's go over some key concepts on the types of disaster or humanitarian crisis and the discovery research, recovery continuum. For the purpose of this lecture, I will use the term disaster and humanitarian crisis interchangeably. In the United States, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, also known as FEMA, is the agency that coordinates the response and recovery associated with most disasters that happen in the 50 US states and territories. This diagram is from one of FEMA's publications. In this diagram, disasters are classified into three categories that somehow overlap. For instance, pandemics are categorized under natural disasters, since many pandemics are vector dependent. But of course, vector-dependent outbreaks also depend on seasonal changes like rain and other seasonal changes. But outbreaks could potentially fall under technological or accidental disasters or even human-caused disasters. Also, among natural disasters, droughts, snowstorms, landslides, and even famine could be included. Famine could also be included under human-caused disasters. Mass displacement, migration, and refugee crises often follow armed conflicts, but also could result from natural disasters. Could human trafficking be considered a humanitarian crisis? Civil unrest, internal or civil wars, armed conflict within and between countries, fall under adversarial and human-caused disasters. Extreme political instability leading to significant violence like genocides, which could also be included under human-caused disasters. Some natural or technological or accidental disasters may lead to prolonged power outages, disruption in communications, or extended lack of potable water, thus exacerbating the ongoing events. No matter the category, these events result in countless damages and material losses. Yet, most importantly, their impact on human lives can last decades and is core of our interest. Our aim at performing health research linked to humanitarian crises should be the preservation of human lives and the reduction of the impact of these events, both in the short and the long term. Since some of you who are watching this course live in the United States, I would like to briefly explain the Stafford Act. The Stafford Act, or law, created the authority given to federal agencies, including FEMA and the Department of Health and Human Services, to coordinate disaster response and recovery with the states and local governments. Under the Stafford Act, there are two categories for public health emergencies: public health emergencies in itself and major disasters. Public health emergencies relate mostly to pandemics or other emergencies that could have an impact on public safety. Major disasters are a broader category that includes natural disasters or disasters caused by human acts that have a much greater magnitude than that of public health emergencies. However, some public health emergencies could be declared major disasters, like the COVID-19 pandemic. In other countries, local emergency management agencies and other government agencies have designed their own protocols and laws regarding disaster management. In both the US and other countries, individuals, local healthcare systems, as well as a variety of local and international organizations also play key roles in disaster response and recovery. This graph illustrates the disaster recovery continuum based on the National Disaster Recovery Framework proposed by FEMA in the United States. However, this continuum could certainly apply to any disaster or humanitarian crisis around the world. Recovery starts before the disaster hits, with preparedness. The degree and detail of the preparedness are expected to have a cascading effect on the speed and completeness of the response, which, as you see in here in the first stage, it happens right after the event and ends a few weeks or months later, and the recovery, which extends for years. I also want to note that the length of both the response and the recovery will not only depend on preparedness, but also on the magnitude of the and the type of the disaster. So this has to be considered as well. This graphic illustrates four stages, but they are not completely independent or separate from each other. They are rather interdependent. Some activities take place within specific time frames or either within the response or the recovery, but other activities take place along the continuum. For instance, during the preparedness phase, recovery planning, community needs assessments, training and capacity assessments should be performed. And emergency protocols need to be maintained up to date as well. In other words, during the preparedness phase, we need to make sure that everything is working. Therefore, when the disaster hits, we can deal with it the best way we can. During the early or short-term stage within the response, emergency services, public health, and healthcare services are activated. Also, evacuation and relocation into shelters, emotional, psychological, psychiatric support are going to be provided to those affected. There is also going to be some debris management to clear the roads and provide some access, and some immediate restoration of businesses and establishing some temporary infrastructure is going to happen. And mitigation activities are going to start with some initial repair and rebuilding. Also, during this stage, it's critical that we check that essential services are in order, for example, healthcare, water, energy, communications. During the intermediate phase, there's going to be then some interim housing, moving from shelters to some more permanent or semi-permanent housing, some infrastructure repair and restoration, and ensuring continuity of healthcare and access to the usual social and healthcare services, and engaging communities to build back stronger would ideally take place. And in the long term, permanent housing, economic revitalization, and reestablishing disrupted systems, especially healthcare services and other vital systems, is important and critical. And also during this long term stage, rehearsing lessons learned from the disaster and incorporating into an emergency plan need to happen in preparation for future disasters. However, as I mentioned before, the degree of preparedness and the type of and magnitude of the disaster will influence the length of the response and the recovery. And sometimes you could see that they shift back and forth depending on how fragile or how strong the underlying conditions were before the disaster.